بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم امر الله الله اكبر الله اكبر الله اكبر Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, starting literally a minute or so, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, mashallah, accept. I took you off later. I only keep him for like 24 hours and then I take you off. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah. Allah keep us all sincere, inshallah. Umri Allah. Okay, inshallah, let's get ready. Allahu Akbar. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammad. Finishing the chapter of patience, inshallah, and starting the chapter of sidq, truthfulness. Oh Allah. How are you, Raihan? You okay? Alhamdulillah.
So, you know, in this, you have to change it. You change this now.
I've heard. Alexa. Direct news.
When the Bangladesh was on, give me one strawberry. That was quite nice. Smashed that last time. I had it all day today. What is it? You know why you have this little tube. Throwing it to the
Allah Abraham. Okay, inshallah, we are going to start literally in a minute. Please hang on, people. Allahu Akbar. Assalamu alaikum. The video, okay? Assalamu alaikum. Inshallah, starting in literally 1 minute, inshallah, Rahman, inshallah, inshallah. How are you, Mizan bhai? You okay? Mizan bhai, hello, sir. Allahu Akbar. Okay, inshallah, we'll start, inshallah. If everyone could come a bit closer, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan ahsan al-jaza. Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وإمام المتقين وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين وقال سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما وقال حبيبنا صلى الله عليه وسلم ما يزال البلاء بالمؤمن والمؤمنة في نفسه وولده وماله حتى يلقى الله سبحانه وتعالى وما عليه خطيئة، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: اللهم صل على محمد كلما ذكره الذاكرون، وصل على محمد كلما غفل عن ذكره الغافلون. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. يا رب العالمين، زدنا علما بالقرآن العظيم وبسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. Today is the 161st lesson of Hadith, consecutive 161st Friday of Hadith, and the 12th lesson of Riyad al-Salihin. Only through the sheer mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has allowed it so that another week has passed from one Friday to another Friday. We find in a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that person who finds one Jumu'ah and then finds the next Jumu'ah, all of his minor sins and all of her minor sins in between are forgiven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed it so that we can gather again despite disobeying Allah. If I was to look back at my week, I am sure there's been many points in that week where I've disobeyed Allah. Allah has not been happy with me. And I'm sure if we all was to ponder over our lives, then we will come to find that there are points in our lives where Allah was not happy. And we disobeyed Allah knowingly, unknowingly. But despite all this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has still giving me and you the tawfiq, the ability to come in a gathering wherein the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my beloved and your beloved, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is being mentioned. So this is an extreme favor of Allah. When a person appreciates it as a favor, he says Alhamdulillah with the depths of his or her heart. And when that is said, Allah will give you more and Allah will give me more ability. We've got literally three ahadith left before we finish the chapter of sabr. And inshallah, we'll start the chapter of Sidq, speaking the truth. So the hadith number 50 from Riyadu Salihin, Imam Nawawi, rahimahullahu ta'ala, mentions the hadith from وعن ابن عباس radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma قال ابن عباس radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, the cousin brother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said قَدِمَ عُيَيْنَةُ بْنِ حِسٍ فَنَزَلَ عَلَى بْنِ أَخِيهِ الْحُرِّ بْنِ قَيْسِ. A man named Uyayna came to visit his cousin brother Hur. Hur was وكان من النفر الذين يدنيهم عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه. Umar رضي الله عنه, when he was the Khalifa of Islam, Umar after Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه was the first Khalifa of Islam, who became the ruler and the Amir, the leader of the believers for approximately 2 years. Thereafter, Umar رضي الله تعالى عنه was the second Khalifa of Islam. So whilst Umar was the Khalifa of Islam, he used to have an attendee called Hur, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So Hur, his cousin brother Uyayna, came to visit him. وَكَانَ الْقُرَّاءُ أَصْحَابَ مَجْلِسٍ عُمَرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَ عَنْهُ وَمُشَاوَرَتِهِ كُهُولًا كَانُوا أَوْ شُبَّانًا. Hur was so accepted in the court of Umar, despite his young age, he used to be in them gatherings where Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to have a gathering of the senior companions and of the senior advice people that were with him. So Hud used to be invited in this court of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is how much he was accepted by Umar. Why was he accepted? Al-Qurra. He was amongst the great reciters of the glorious Quran, this person Hur. So one day when Uyayna came to visit him, فَقَالَ عُيَيْنَ لِبْنِ أَخِيهِ, Uyayna said to Hur, يَبْنَ أَخِي لَكَ وَجْهٌ إِنْدَ هَذَا الْأَمِيرِ فَاسْتَأْذِنْ لِي عَلَيْهِ. Oh my beloved cousin brother Hur, you have a very close attachment to Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Please take me to Umar. I want to speak to him. فَاسْتَأْذَنَ فَأَذِنَ لَهُ Umar. So Hur took his cousin brother Uyayna, who had come to visit him in Medina, and he had taken him to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and asked permission from Umar. Umar gave permission. فَلَمَّا دَخَلَ, when Uyayna entered, قال, he said, هِيَ يَبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَ عَنْهُ. Oh, Ibn Khattab. So he's referring to the ruler who is the ruler and the leader of the believers, Amirul Mu'mineen. So this Uyayna, he is showing his arrogance and showing disrespect. Rather than calling him Amirul Mu'mineen, he says, "Oh, you, the son of Khattab." That was the name of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Umar ibn Khattab. So he says, "Yabna Khattab, oh you the son of Khattab, fawallahi, I swear by Allah, ma tu'atina al-jazla wa la tahkumu fina bil-adl. I swear by Allah, you do not give the salary and the benefits of the believers in true justice. You're not just in your distributing of salary and in your distributing of wages towards the believers." For example, at that time, the scholars of the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they used to be given a certain share of money so that they can exercise their time in only seeking and acquiring and teaching knowledge. So they were paid, which was known as a wadhifa, when you give someone their salary, their fixed wage. So this person said that, "Umar, you do not deal with justice. You are not just in your distributing of wealth." فَغَضِبَ عُمَرُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَ عَنْهُ حَتَّى حَمَّ أَيُّقِيَ بِهِ. So Hur says, "I saw the face of Umar change." Umar became very angry. Umar became very angry, and to the point, I could feel as though Umar was very, you could say, hot-tempered when he needed to be for the sake of Allah. So Umar was becoming very, very angry, and I felt as though the Umar will do something to my cousin Uyayna. Seeing this, Hur, being a man of knowledge, a man of Quran, he knew something that Uyayna did not know about Umar. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a very sincere man. And if there is anything that can melt the heart of Umar, then that was the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but more so, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Hur, seeing that Umar is becoming angry, he's going to say something to my cousin Uyayna. Uyayna doesn't know. He doesn't know the etiquettes of speaking to a leader. He doesn't know the etiquettes of who Umar actually is. So Hur, seeing this, فَقَالَ لَهُ الْحُرْ. Hur says that he said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, O the leader of the believers, إِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى قَالَ لِنَبِيِّهِ. O Amir al-Mu'mineen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator Allah the Almighty, he said to his Rasul," meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "the following words, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين." That, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for you it is that you have af, that you learn to forgive, وأمر بالعرف, and that you command with kindness, with goodness, وأعرض عن الجاهلين, and that you turn away from the ignorant, the jahil, the person that doesn't understand, you turn away from them. As soon as Umar heard these verses from Hur, Hur was very clever that I can't say to Umar, "Umar, calm down, calm down." Umar won't listen. He won't listen if I said to him, "Calm down." The only way to make Umar listen is you recite the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar stopped. وَإِنَّ هَذَا مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ. And oh Umar, my cousin Uyayna, he is amongst the ignorant. He doesn't know. He doesn't know the etiquettes. He doesn't know what he's saying. وَاللَّهِ مَا جَاوَزَهَا عُمَرُ حِينَ تَلَاهَا. Hur says, "I swear by Allah, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as soon as he heard these words, anger, everything extinguished. He became calm. Because Allah said to the Rasul, that for you is to be merciful. خُذِ الْعَفْوَ. Pardon people. وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. And turn away from the bad people. Turn away from the ignorant. There's no point arguing with them. So as soon as he heard this, he controlled himself. وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا عِنْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi mentioned this hadith. And he says that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as soon as he came to the book of Allah, he adhered strictly to the words of Allah. And a man that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a man who rules with justiceness, a man that has power over the people, but as soon as you say to him the words of Allah, he learns to control himself. He learns to have patience. So here Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi is saying to me and you, the how upsetting it is that we have become so far from the book of Allah that when we recite the book of Allah, if someone says to me and you that Allah says don't do this, still it is not enough for me and you to change our ways. Where Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he has now reached the pinnacle of being angry. He's angry, he's annoyed that someone is speaking to him like this. But as soon as you utter the words of Allah, even someone like Umar becomes very soft. And this very Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, why does he have this close relationship with the book of Allah? We find regarding Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because of him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the wanting of Umar, many verses of the glorious Quran were revealed. For example, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went for the final Hajj, And the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala, they were circulating the Kaaba, the house of Allah. And they were doing the tawaf, which is 7 times circulating the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thereafter, Umar stopped at Maqam Ibrahim, that place where Ibrahim alayhi salam stood with his son Ismail and made the dua, رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ. And he made the dua of Allah, accept this from me. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, when he said in front of the house of Allah with his son Ismail, Umar radiallahu ta'ala stopped and he said, and Rasulullah is still continuing. Rasulullah says, Umar, why do you stop for? Umar says, O Messenger of Allah, my heart desires that now that we have completed the tawaf of the house of Allah, the Kaaba, I feel to show gratitude, we should offer 2 rakats of salah. 2 rakats of nafal salah, of salah, in front of Maqam Ibrahim to show our thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah says, Umar, I can't make the ruling. I am not the one that makes the rules. I am the one that portrays and gives you the message of the rule. The rule and the hukum and the command is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can't do anything. It's not my deen. It's the deen of Allah. I can't make that decision. But as soon as Umar said this, before Rasulullah can even leave the holy sanctuary of the house of Allah, the Kaaba, Masjid al-Haram, Jibreel alayhi salam descends with the verses of وَاتَّخَذَ مَقَامَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى, that Allah has decided, according to the way Umar spoke, that the Maqam Ibrahim is now going to be till the end of times, till Qiyamah, every Haji will come, and they will have to offer the 2 rakats of Salah in Maqam Ibrahim, because of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Numerous occasions in the life of Umar, and he was turned by the Qur'an, so he had a very great connection with the Book of Allah. And me and you, if there's one thing that we need to really focus on, it is this, that we need to connect to the Book of Allah. Mere recitation, yes, it is virtuous, very virtuous. Memorizing the Book of Allah, indeed very virtuous. But there's one more step, which is trying to understand the command of Allah, trying to understand this message that Allah has brought. For this we need to make an effort, and we need to find such avenues where the Book of Allah is being discussed. For example, here on Monday, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, we've had over 5 lessons of tafsir now, where we have started the glorious Quran from Surah Al-Fatiha. We are now on Surah Al-Baqarah, approximately verse number 13 or 14 now. And we have made a promise and an attempt to try to speak regarding the Book of Allah every Monday, as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows. May Allah make it so that when we hear the words of Allah, our hearts are softened. وعن ابن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إنا ستكون بعدي أثرة وأمور تنكرونها قالوا يا رسول الله. حضرت ابن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه, a great companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, says that Rasulullah said to us that, O my companions, a time will come after me, a group of people will come, such leaders will come, and you will not like them. You will not like what they do. They will act, they will rule against the way of the Quran, against my way. Qalu, the companion said, Ya Rasulullah, fama ta'muruna, O Messenger of Allah, what do you command us to do then? At that time when you will no longer be with us, what do you command us to do? Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ta'udduna al-haqqa alladhi alaykum, wa tas'aluna Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alladhi lakum. Continue to stay on the truth. This truth that you are on now, continue to stay steadfast on this truth. Don't let anyone come your way. Don't let anyone take you away from this truth. And always know that you can only ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't ask from the people anymore. Turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From this we understand that at times, we will be faced with those things and those hindrances in life, in the form of people, in the form of problems in our life. But we can't just give up. We can't just think to ourselves that things are not going my way. I don't like what's around me. I don't like the negativity around me. How do you counter it? Turn towards Allah and you stay firm. If you are on the truth and you know you're doing good, then you should continue to strive towards this good. وَعَنْ عَبِي يَحْيَى أُسَيْدٍ بِنْ هُذَيْرٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَ عَنْهُمْ أَنَّ رَجُلًا مِنَ الْأَنْصَارِ قَالَ أُسَيْدٍ بِنْ هُذَيْرٍ radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who was Usayd ibn Hudayr? His name is possible that no one has heard his name before. He is a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His name is Usayd ibn Hudayr. Usayd ibn Hudayr, he accepted Islam quite late. He accepted Islam in Medina Munawwara. So over 13 years of prophethood had passed and he accepted Islam. He was known to be a beautiful reciter of the glorious Quran, Usayd ibn Hudayr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. From him we only have 18 ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He passed away in the year 20 after Hijri in Medina Munawwara. He is buried in Jannatul Baqi, and his janaza salah was led by the Amirul Mu'mineen of the time, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He led the janaza salah of Usayd ibn Hudayr. This Usayd ibn Hudayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that a man from the Ansar, in reality, he was the man. But such was the way that the Sahaba spoke about themselves, that if they wanted to teach the Ummah something, they wouldn't just say that, oh, it was me. Rather, they would make it into third person and say, when they were narrating the story, that a man from the Ansar, i.e. himself, qala, said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, Ala tasta'miluni kama sta'malta fulanan. O Messenger of Allah, will you not appoint me to be a governor? Will you not appoint me to be your ambassador? The way you have appointed such and such a person, fulanan. In this hadith, the word fulanan is used. And this is a hadith of Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahimahullahu ta'ala, says that who was that person that he's talking about? So Usayd says, O Messenger of Allah, will you not make me a governor? Will you not make me an ambassador the way you made such a companion an ambassador? That such a companion was called Amr ibn As, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. That you made him the governor and you made him an ambassador whenever Rasulullah used to go out of Medina Munawwara, he needed to leave someone behind to take charge. He would appoint different people. In this case, he appointed Amr bin As. Who is Amr bin As? And I love always repeating this hadith to everyone, only to show you how much love Rasulullah showed to his companions. Amr bin As, a hadith of Shama'il Tirmizi, Imam Tirmizi, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions, Amr bin As, he himself says, once I was in the gathering of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and whilst being in his gathering, Rasulullah started to speak to us. From amongst all of the people, that day for some reason, he started to show me extra attention. So much so that he's talking, but all of his attention is towards me. He's showing me extra love. He's showing me extra attention. He's not minding those around me. And in that moment, because he's showing me so much love, Amr bin As says, I said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, can I ask you something? Na'am, ask. He said, O Messenger of Allah, who is the most beloved to you? Who is the most beloved to you? Amr bin As, feeling so special at that moment, he felt as though I must be the most beloved. So he asked, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved to you? Rasulullah said, Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala. Abu Bakr is the beloved to me. Thumma man, Ya Rasulullah, after him, who is this? Who's next? Rasulullah said, Umar radiyallahu ta'ala is the most beloved to me. Thumma man, after him, Uthman radiyallahu ta'ala. Amr bin As says, then I stopped. I didn't ask further. I felt as though that my name will come where? 50th, 100th, somewhere down the line, and I won't be amongst the first few. But the ulama mentioned a very beautiful point, which is the point that we need to remember. Amr bin As, why did he stop? He could have said after, Uthman, it's possible who would come next? Ali would have come next. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The commentators of this hadith say that we have that much belief and determination that the next name would have been Ali radiallahu anhu. But he didn't ask further. Why did he not ask further? And this is the point that me and you need to remember. He didn't ask further because at that moment in time, he felt the most special. He felt as though that Rasulullah must love me so much, and he didn't want that feeling to go. By asking more, that feeling will go, that I must be the beloved to him, the most beloved to him. Just so that feeling, however long that feeling will last, just so that that feeling lasts, and it's a moment for him to always treasure, he didn't ask further. So that he feels as though I was the most beloved to the Prophet. And this miracle, this quality, I swear by Allah, no one can possess it except for Rasulullah. That in a gathering, that every person feels as though that I must be the most special to him. How much attention he used to give to one companion, that companion felt as though that there is no one better than me. I must be the most beloved to him. He made everyone feel like this. For me and you, just to even make our loved ones feel special is our mission and a task in itself. For Rasulullah did this with every single of his companions, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So this Usayd says, Rasulullah then replied saying, فَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ سَلَّمْ إِنَّكُمْ سَتَلْقَوْنَ بَعْدِي أَثَرَةً. After me, indeed, you will be faced with a group of people. فَصْبِرُوا. Have patience. Until when? حَتَّى تَلْقَوْنِي عَلَى الْحَوْضِ. Until you come and meet me on the Hawd al-Kawthar, on the fountain where I will present you with the blessed water from my own hands. So Rasulullah said to them, have patience. Patience until you meet me again. Because after me, after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will leave the face of this earth, you cannot expect the same barakah, the same goodness to be around. The companions say that we swear by Allah, the day Rasulullah entered Medina Munawwara, it was the most beautifulest of all of days. But that day when he left the world, the face of this earth, we swear by Allah, there was no darker day than this day in Medina Munawwara, that Rasulullah has left the face of this earth. وعن ابن إبراهيم عبد الله ابن عوفة رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعد أيامه التي لقي فيها عدو انتظر حتى إذا مالت الشمس قام فيهم. The companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, عبد الله ابن أبي عوفة. Who is عبد الله ابن أبي عوفة? He is that companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم who was the last companion to pass away in Kufa. Final companion. After Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we only find approximately 10,000 bodies that are buried in Mecca and Medina of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We also know from the hadith of Hajjatul Wida on the final sermon, there was approximately over 114,000 or 144,000 or 124,000 companions present on the final sermon of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. From amongst them, only approximately 10,000 are buried in Medina and in Mecca. From this, the ulama explain, because the rest of the companions knew that بَلِّغُوا أَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً, that you need to spread this work. You need to spread this Islam across the whole four corners of the world. So they went. That's why you will find that in China, in Spain, the likes of Russia, the likes of India, many other places around the world, many, many graves of the companions radiyallahu ta'ala anhum are there. Because they went out to propagate Islam. So this companion, Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, was the final companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pass away in Kufa. He's a very special companion. He took the pledge of Ridwan. Ridwan is that treaty where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the companions that take my hand, that you will take and accept this pledge from me. Allah was so happy with this pledge that Allah ta'ala mentions in Suratul Inna Fatahna Laka Fatham Mubin. Fathan Mubina, in the 26th part of the Quran, that Allah is happy with all those that took their pledge with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is amongst them. He passed away what year? 87 after Hijri in Kufa, and from him the Ummah has found 95 ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says that once we were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he gave us some advice. He said, "Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, la tatamannaw liqa'al adu, do not wish to meet your enemies. Don't wish that you meet your enemies face to face. Was'alullah al-afiyah." Ask Allah only for goodness, afiyah. Don't ask Allah for trouble. Don't ask Allah to fight. That is not the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is a last resort. Wherever Rasulullah went on an expedition, the objective wasn't to fight. Rasulullah himself says that I have been sent to give this message of kalima, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. I have not been sent for fighting. But if the people are wanting to hurt us, then we will defend ourselves. فَإِذَا لَقِيتُمْ, if you meet your enemies, فَاصْبِرُوا, have patience. وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ تَحْتَ ذِلَاءِ السُّيُوفِ, and know that Jannah lies in this path, lies in the path of Allah and His Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثُمَّ قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صلى الله عليه وسلم, thereafter Rasulullah made a very powerful dua, and to this day, whenever the ummah is in any sort of difficulty, this same dua is repeated. The dua is, اللهم منزل الكتاب, O Allah, you the one that revealed the book. ومجري السحاب, you the one that sends the clouds. وحازم الأحزاب, you the one that destroys the enemy. أهزمهم وانصرنا عليهم, O Allah, we ask you to destroy them. O Allah, we ask you to help us. From this we find out that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches me a very important lesson. And that lesson is that always ask Allah for goodness, but keep in mind, the world is not a pretty place. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi ends on this hadith, putting a fine balance between patience and not being too naive and being too blind to the situation around you. People will do you wrong. People will. I am sorry to say to you, no matter how much good you offer to people, I swear by Allah, it is the rule of life. There's someone out there or someone in some sort of way, they won't want goodness for you. It might be the disease of jealousy. It might be the disease of hate. Whatever it may be, they won't be happy. And there will be people out there all the time trying to do wrong to you. What do? Have patience. But if it comes to a point where your patience can't bear you with these people, then you talk to Allah. Oh Allah, there are negative people around me. Oh Allah, you make such situations, such solutions in my life that all these negative people, if I know them, I don't know them, that they slowly move away from me. Because no one wants negativity in their life. No one wants negative people around them. So patience doesn't just mean that, yeah, you take everything, you take every punch. No. If a person is in an abusive relationship, husband and wife, that does not mean that as a wife, that the message and the advice is to her, that yeah, it's fine, continue being patient, continue being patient. No. That is not the advice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor is it the advice of our deen. Our deen says, have patience. But if it comes to a point where you can't bear it anymore, then the rule isn't patience. Then the rule is you need to do something about it. And in the case where people are abusive in their relationships, at that point, you need to remove the negative people from your life. That is the last resort. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me and you to understand this. Babu Sidd. After the chapter of patience, Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi wants to say something more to me and you, which is, with patience, sometimes one of the greatest messages is truthfulness. How true are you? And if I'm being very honest with you, in this day and age, many of us are liars. We are liars. Why are we liars? Why are we liars to ourselves? Because we say those things that suit us. We say those things that suit us, and sometimes we call it sugarcoating the truth, or it's a blatant lie. Our Islam teaches me and you that whatever happens, you need to speak the truth. And this truth, how important is it? You will find out from Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi. As is his practice, at the beginning of every chapter, he starts with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Nawawi says, قَالَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَكُونُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ وقال سبحانه وتعالى والصادقين والصادقات وقال سبحانه وتعالى فلو صدق الله لكان خيرا لهم. He mentions three verses of the glorious Quran. The first verse is, O you who believe, اتقوا الله. Fear the displeasure of Allah. Don't make Allah unhappy. Don't become amongst those people that easily disobey Allah. Learn to fear Allah. How will you fear Allah? وَكُونُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ. Learn to stay with the truthful people. Here the ulama mention an amazing point, the masters of tafsir. This Quran, every single person sitting here, those listening at home, and as a believer, it is our belief, the belief of every believer, that the Quran is the book of Allah. Until the day of Qiyamah, it will always remain in its true form on the face of this earth. Everyone believe that? This is the words of Allah. It can never be changed. Allah Himself set that challenge. Allah says, Inna nahnu, in Suratul Para 14, the first side of Para 14, Alif Lam Ra, Suratul Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says therein that, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikr. We have taken the responsibility to protect our book. We don't need anyone. We don't need Hafiz Sahib. We don't need the book in a Quran, the Quran in a book form. Allah said, we have protected it and we will protect it however we want. That's why Allah chooses some souls. That's why Allah chooses some hearts. That's why Allah chooses some hands to write the book of Allah. So Allah chooses this. So Allah says, I will protect it. From this verse, Allah says, O you who believe, have taqwa, have the consciousness that I don't want to disobey Allah, and stay with the truthful people. Because this verse of the Quran is till the day of Qiyamah, that means till the day of Qiyamah, Wallahi al-Azim, there will always be truthful people in the face of this earth. Always. They might be a minority. There might be a few. So if you do find such gems, make sure you hold on to them. If you find a person who is true to his words, a woman who is true to her words, then I swear by Allah, that woman is worth it. And that man is worth staying and being in his company. Why? Because these truthful person, truthful people are a few in number. So Allah says, stay with the truthful. Allah also, when He describes in Para 22 regarding some qualities of the believers, Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ. Allah talks about a few qualities. The believing man, the believing men, the believing women, the truthful men, the truthful women. So Allah praises them. And Allah says, فَلَوْ صَدَقُ اللَّهَ. If they had been truthful to Allah, indeed that would have been better for them. Now Imam Nawawi starts the hadith. Listen to this hadith very, very carefully. It's a very important hadith, and this will kind of be the center of what I wanted, the message that I wanted to give today. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ قَالَ. Who is Ibn Mas'ud? It's a very, very important point that I want to mention to you about Ibn Mas'ud. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu is that companion who the companions say, وَهُوَ يُشَبِّهُ مِنْهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. He is amongst those companions that used to resemble Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you saw Ibn Mas'ud from a distance, you would think that that is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way he used to walk, it was as though it was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was very close to Rasulullah, the sixth Muslim, the sixth person to accept Islam. So he was there from the initial stages of Islam. He is a great companion. He is a companion who is amongst those four companions who were responsible for writing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Mas'ud, his qira'at, his recitation of the glorious Quran, to this day is still present. And that is the Uthmani print that we read. It is from verses of the Uthmani print, is from the verses and from the print and from the writing of Ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna as-sidqa," that the truth, "yahdi ila al-bir," it will take you towards goodness, being truthful. "Wa inna al-birra," and goodness, "yahdi ila al-jannah," it will take you towards Jannah. "Wa inna ar-rajula la yasduqu," a person, he continues to strive in speaking the truth, hatta, until yukdaba inda Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until a point comes that he is so fashioned to speak the truth. No matter what happens, good to him, bad to him, he still stands for the truth. Until a point comes that in the sight of Allah, he is written and he is known as Siddiq. He is known as the one who is very, very truthful. From every single person in this ummah that was given the title of Siddiq, because Siddiqat and Sadaqat, to be truthful, after prophethood, it is the most virtuous act. Why do I say this? In the Juz 5, in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, وَأَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, Allah has bestowed His favors upon who? مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ, upon the prophets. Thereafter, وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ, after the prophets, straight after, Allah says He has blessed the truthful people. A person who doesn't fear saying the truth, a person who doesn't hold back, that when he knows something is the truth, the people, because he will lose a gathering, because he will lose friends, because he will lose a following, he finds it shy to hide away the truth. No, that is not the way of deen. Deen has not come to fulfill my and your desires. It's not about how me and you feel. It is the words of Allah. It is the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If me and you like it or not, if it's a bitter pill or not, I'm sorry. It is the truth. And the truth has to be said. So here we find that if you are truthful, you will be known to be a Siddiq. Who was Siddiq? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. How much so? I've mentioned this many times. We mentioned it in our class on Wednesday too. But I will mention it for everyone. And I mentioned it to the boys in Ashton last week in our program. But I will mention it again. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, why was he called Siddiq? Abu Bakr Siddiq. Why was he known as the truthful? Why was he given this honor? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the 11th and a half year, we find that he went on that night journey towards Mi'raj. And after, when he returned, in one night, he went through the heavens, the seven heavens. He went to Sidratul Muntaha. He was conversing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He went from Masjid al-Haram to Masjid al-Aqsa, all in one night, and time had frozen. Time froze to such an extent, nothing had changed. When he was returned back to Umm Hani's house, the way he had left and the door was still swinging and the items around the house were still moving, he returned in that exact same state. So when this had happened, Rasulullah in the morning, he informed the disbelievers of Mecca that I went to Masjid al-Aqsa. Masjid al-Aqsa! Masjid al-Aqsa is so many thousands of miles away. You went to Masjid al-Aqsa? Yes, I did. Okay. How many doors of Masjid Aqsa? How many windows of Masjid Aqsa? Rasulullah didn't go to see the windows and doors. He was busy leading the salah for all of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when this was asked, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a projected screen of the view of Masjid Aqsa. Rasulullah counted the doors, the windows, and he said to the disbelievers, Masjid Aqsa has that many doors and has that many windows. And this, and Rasulullah said, and there is a caravan that is returning to Mecca. The distance where I left yet, approximately 30 days it will take this caravan to return to Mecca. Guess what? After 30 days, that caravan returned. But when Rasulullah said this, they made him a laughing stock. And when people make you a laughing stock and they want to take away your honor, take away the goodness that you have, the best way and the fastest way to do that is to go to the people that mean a lot to you or love you dearly and to spread rumors to them and to say to them that, oh, have you heard? So who did they go to, these disbelievers? They went to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. They said to Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr, what have you heard? What Muhammad is saying? What's my Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is he saying? Oh, he's saying that from in one night he went from Masjid al-Haram to Masjid al-Aqsa to the seven heavens and he still came back and all this happened. Look what your Muhammad is saying now. You spent over 11 years with him and now look what he's saying. You know, if you thought it was, you know, you believed in everything before, but look now. No one will believe. And they started to ridicule. They started to tell Abu Bakr, look at the nonsense that this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. Abu Bakr said, did Muhammad say all this? Did my Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say all this? Yeah, he said it. And just to kind of confirm that if it's true or not. Abu Bakr said, Wallahi lazim, Wallahi. If he has said it, qad sadaqa. I swear by Allah, he is truthful and he definitely said it and it definitely happened. From that moment on, Jibreel alayhi wa sallam, we find in a narration that he comes and says, the Messenger of Allah, in the heavens, Abu Bakr is no longer known as Abu Bakr. From this moment on, he is known as As-Siddiq. The one who is truthful. And not only is he truthful, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, just to add this point, not only was he Siddiq, his daughter, who is my and your mother, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was Siddiqa. She was also truthful. And there is a whole long hadith called the Hadith al-Ifk, where the liars and the disbelievers and the hypocrites of Medina Munawwara made an evil lie towards Aisha radiallahu anha. An evil lie. And she went through a hard time. She went through such a hard time that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to go to his wife, Aisha radiallahu anha. And he said to his wife, that, oh my wife, Aisha radiallahu anha, if you have done this wrong, if it is true that you have dishonored me, if it is true, then know that Allah ta'ala is the most forgiving. A husband is saying to his wife, know that Allah is the most forgiving and know that Allah will forgive your sins. And if you are truthful and you have not committed this evil, then Allah will make some sort of way that I will know, I will be informed and you will be cleared from this. Aisha hearing this, she says, I was crying for over a month. When my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this, my tears froze. No tears came out. That my husband, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he doesn't know, he will only know when Allah will inform him. He's a human being. Allah is testing his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the greatest honor that a man can have, which is his wife. So now she is shocked that he doesn't know. He doesn't even believe enough to know that I didn't do anything wrong. I have not done anything. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, she moves away from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a state where she is crying, in a state where she is hurt. She says to her mother, the answer, Sali li Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, answer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for me. Say that I am clear, that I am innocent. And her mother says, Allah and his Rasul know best. We don't know. Abu Bakr, her father, answer. You are the closest to Rasulullah. Tell him that I am innocent. I haven't done any wrong. Abu Bakr says, how can I answer if Rasulullah doesn't know? I don't know. You're my daughter. I trust you. I know you haven't done anything wrong. But if Allah hasn't said anything, if his Rasul can't say anything, I can't say anything. At that moment, Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, I turn away my face. When I turn away my face, hadith of Sahih Bukhari, it comes in Sahih Bukhari 18 times in this hadith of Ifk. She turns around and now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going through that state which he goes through, which is in the cold winter months when there is extreme cold temperature. Rasulullah starts to profuse excessively. He is sweating from his forehead. And Surah An-Nur, which is in Juz number 18, Surah An-Nur, from the second ruku of Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals 13 verses, a whole ruku in the honor of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. Inna alladhina ja'u bil ifki usbatun minkum. Those that spoke a lie against Aisha, Allah does not want any man or any woman to come forward. Allah is enough as a witness for her. Allah testifies for Aisha. Allah calls her Siddiqa, that she is the truthful. Father is Siddiq, daughter is Siddiqa. It's a great, great trait, to be honest. No matter how hard it is. And this hadith of ifk, I was just thinking, I mentioned to some of my friends, I pray Allah Ta'ala give me the tawfiq. I want to spend a whole day, an event, wherever, whichever masjid may be, inshallah, very soon. But I'm going to dedicate a whole program on this hadith of Sahih Bukhari, known as the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, hadith al-ifq. But I will explain the whole, I've mentioned it before in hadith class in parts, but I want to do it in one gathering, and I will explain these points of what Aisha went through. But she still spoke the truth. So when you speak the truth, it will go against you. Because sometimes you'll be very passionate about the truth and it will go against you. People will deny it. But don't worry. Don't worry. Because Wallahi Lazim, I have not said this. You have not said this. But my Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Hadith of Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, Inna Siddqa Yahdi ila al-Bir. Truth always, Inna, definitely, always will take you towards goodness. It might take some time. You might not see the goodness. You might be in trouble. You might go through a very testing time. But it will take you towards goodness if it is the truth. Ka'b bin Malik, he didn't lie to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We mentioned this hadith in Riyadh al-Salihin. He didn't lie to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. For 50 days, he was tested. 50 days. But he held firm to the truth. I've got no excuse. I can't lie to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He spoke the truth and he was rewarded with the glorious Quran to be his witness. وَعَلَى ثَلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا Then three that stayed back from the battle. And Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّهُ يَتُوبُ عَلَيْهِمْ Allah accepted the repentance. So be truthful. Be truthful. Speak the truth. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. People will go against you. What does truth mean? You're at work. I'm just going to take my 15-minute break. And you come back and your face is wet, your beard is wet, and they know that you used the sink and you made a bit of a puddle. What did you do? Oh, I just went for my break. No, I went to pray Salah. I went to pray Salah. I did it for my Allah. What's there to hide? Be truthful to yourself. Be truthful to Allah. Don't hide away from people. There's no need to hide the truth. The more firm you are on the truth, Allah will open the doors for you. And this is the words of my Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But on the other side of the spectrum, وَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ Know that lying, what does that lead you towards? That leads you towards evil. وَإِنَّ الْفُجُورَ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ And know that every evil will lead you towards the fire of hell. وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ To a point a person continues to lie, لِيَكْذِبُ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى كَذَّابًا He is known as a kazzab, an evil, evil liar in the court of Allah. That he continues to lie, that he's fashioned to lying. He can't even speak the truth anymore. Allah protect us from being amongst those kind of people. The next hadith, An Abi Muhammad al-Hasan ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, qal Hasan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Who is al-Hasan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu? He is the grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The elder grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the son of Ali and the son of Fatima radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Al-Hasan, he passed away in the year 50 after Hijri. He was approximately 6-7 years old when Rasulullah left the face of this earth. From him, we only have 13 ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this hadith is in Tirmizi, and Imam Tirmizi says, هذا حديث صحيح, that this is an authentic hadith from Hasan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Who is Hasan? Hassan is the grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once Rasulullah started the khutbah. You know the khutbah, the Jumu'ah khutbah, Rasulullah is addressing the crowd. And at the back of the masjid, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we find Hassan and then there's Hussein also, playing. And as we would say in our English, messing about. And they're giggling and playing. If it was one of our masjids, then the father would be in a lot of trouble. Then why did you bring your child for? Why are they doing this for? These are the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hassan and Hussein. They are playing, Rasulullah is delivering his khutbah. As soon as he sees his grandchildren, Rasulullah, he mounts off the minbar and he goes towards his grandchildren. He grabs Hassan and Hussein and he brings them and he places them both on his lap and he sits with them and the companions there watching and Rasulullah says, Oh Allah, indeed, your children are a means of this love and they make you very cowardly that you don't want to let go of your children. And then Rasulullah raises Hassan and Hussein. In Al-Adab al-Mufrad hadith we find Rasulullah picks up Hassan in one narration and Hassan starts to put his feet on the chest of Rasulullah climbing onto the body of Rasulullah. Rasulullah picks him up and Rasulullah looks towards the heaven and says, Ya Rabbi, inni uhibbuhu. Oh Allah, I swear that I love this child. I love Hassan. I love him. And he say, Ya Rabbi, oh Allah, you also love this child. And he says, oh Allah, this child, my child, Hassan, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, I love him, oh Allah, you love him. And oh Allah, love all those that love my child, Hassan, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This is how beloved they were to Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hassan, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who is from the family of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says, a mere 6-7-year-old child, he says, قَالَ حَفِظْتُ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ That I had memorized from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a few words. A young child, But he memorizes the words of his grandfather, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says that my grandfather, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said, "Da' ma yaribuka ila ma la yaribuk." Abstain from that thing which causes you to have doubt for that thing which does not take you towards doubt. If something is very doubtful, move away from that thing. Is this okay? Is it not? But this is okay though. Then move away from that thing which is doubtful and go towards that thing which is without doubt. Then he says, my grandfather said, فَإِنَّ الصِّدْقَ تُمَانِينَ. Indeed, speaking the truth is a peace of mind. You don't feel guilty. When you speak the truth, you don't feel guilty. No matter how bitter it might sound, because the truth hurts. Remember that. The truth hurts. The truth does hurt. But no matter how bitter it may sound on the tongue, you will have a peace of mind. Why? Alhamdulillah, I spoke the truth. I said it. I got it out of my system. I spoke the truth. Well, kadhiba, riba, and lying, it's a form of doubt. Because you will lie to one person. To cover that lie, you'll have to lie to someone else. Or you'll forget what you lied about. So you'll have to make something else up. And it continues, and you make a mockery of yourself. So truth in every situation is very, very, very important. Last hadith for today. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we are going to talk about a companion who accepted Islam after the conquest of Makkah. So this companion spent approximately over 20 years, to be precise, 21 years against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. 21 years. Who is he? Abu Sufyan radiyallahu anhu. Abu Sufyan. He was amongst the chiefs of the Quraysh. He took part in the Battle of Badr. He took part in the Battle of Uhud. Not with Rasulullah, against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His wife is Hind. Who is Hind? In the Battle of Uhud, everyone knows, the dear uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Hamza, was martyred. And when he was martyred by Wahshi, this Wahshi that martyred him, he took the body parts, because now they had destroyed the body parts of Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The liver of Hamza was taken out. And Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan, she chewed on the liver of the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is how much difficulty they gave to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You know this Wahshi, he also accepted Islam. Let me tell you about his Islam. He accepted Islam and he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam after the conquest of Makkah. And everyone was very hesitant, because when Rasulullah lost his uncle Hamza, Rasulullah was severely and he was hurt to a different level. His dear uncle Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who is known as Asadullahi wa Asadu Rasuli, the lion of Allah, the lion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he lost him. And Wahshi is the one that speared, so in such a way he speared Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he speared him through his back, and the spear went through in an angle, that he went through his back, and he came through his front area, his stomach, and ripped through his private area and everything, and he stuck him onto the ground. He was stuck onto the ground. This is the force of the spear of Wahshi. He was a black slave from Makkah. When Rasulullah was informed that Wahshi, the one that assassinated and destroyed Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he has also accepted Islam. Wahshi came, hadith of Sahih Bukhari. Wahshi came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah asked, "Hada qatilu Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, are you the one that killed my uncle Hamza?" Wahshi said, "Yes." So Rasulullah asked him that, how? He asked for the description, how did you kill my uncle? What was it? And then he explained to his companions at a later time too, that I could not face Hamza. If it was a one-to-one combat, I know he would take me down. So I looked for him. And Hind, who was his thingy, she was the master and she was the keeper of Wahshi, she said that for you will be a price if you can take the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's Qurayshi, so they had this internal beef and this internal problem with Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Wahshi explained everything, that I went in private and I found him in a spot. I hid behind a pillar, behind a boulder, sorry. When I found the right moment, I speared, and he was very good with his target, and I took the life of Hamza. And they also dissembled the body of Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and the liver was taken out. Rasulullah heard all of this and he said something to Wahshi. He said to Wahshi, hadith of Sahih Bukhari, "Oh Wahshi, you have accepted Islam. Every wrong that you have done," this is talking about his uncle now, "every wrong that you have done by accepting Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven every single wrong that you've done. Forgiven. But oh Wahshi, I have a request from you. And that request is, oh Wahshi, when you come in my gathering, because he's a companion now. He's radiallahu anhu. He has seen Rasulullah, so he become a companion. Oh, Washi, when you come to my companion, please don't show me your face. Don't show me your face. Because when you will show me your face, I will remember my uncle Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. I will remember my dear uncle. And because you were the one that took his life, it's possible. It's possible that I will say something against you, or I will think ill. And if the Rasul makes a dua, even an emotional dua from his heart, then Allah will accept this. So he said to Wahshi, please don't come in front of me. That very Wahshi, he used to sit in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with his whole face covered, enough for one of his eyes to show. He used to sit right at the back. Why? Just so he does not give any sort of trouble to the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if I'm being honest with you, that's when Rasulullah is in front. To be very serious with you, because this is a very serious topic, and it's a topic of talking about being truthful. Wallahi lazim, we need to ask ourselves. Wallahi lazim, hand on heart. I need to ask myself. Atiqur Rahman needs to ask himself. You all need to ask yourselves also. How true am I to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? If a man who is now, his everything is cleared, he has got the certificate of Jannah, radiyallahu anhu, Allah is pleased with him. He is going to Jannah. It is the belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, all of them will be going to Jannah without a doubt. He has got the certificate of Jannah. But because his Rasul will feel upset seeing his face and remember something, he stays away from directly being in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How truthful are we to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Day in, day out, we claim to be people of Sunnah. And you know, all these rulings that we go on about. And one thing I personally don't like, which is the whole fiqh mindset, which is this halal, is this haram? But it's only Sunnah though. But it's okay, it's makruh, but it's okay, don't it? That should not be our mentality. Why is that our mentality? When we look into the life of the Sahaba radiallahu, there was no such thing as wajib, sunnat muakkada, wajib, sunnat, nawafil, mustahab, this is farz, this is not farz, the four rakats before Zuhr Salah, or the two rakats after Maghrib, or these two rakats. It wasn't. There was no difference of sunnah, wajib, there was nothing there. Because for them it was, Rasulullah did it. So he prayed three rakats, after that he prayed two, then he prayed two. Okay, I'm going to pray that. There was no need for this. And now today, me and you, the upsetting thing is that that's there, that's fiqh. Put the fiqh aside. So many people ask questions that, oh, but it's sunnah though, isn't it? It's sunnah to do this, or it's sunnah to do this sunnah. It's sunnah to use the miswak. No, it's not just sunnah. Change that word. Take away sunnah, because we don't know what sunnah means. Forget that word for now. The word or the phrase should be, oh, so Rasulullah did this. This is what Rasulullah did. This is what my Rasul did. My beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. That's what it should be changed for. This is why in our life, Wallahi lazim, we are failing. We think to ourselves that there are many ways, many avenues to deen. That this is the way to deen, this is another way to deen. I'm sorry, there's not many avenues. There's only one avenue. And that avenue is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how do we know? I'm not saying this anymore. Rasulullah is not saying this. Allah says in Surah Ali Imran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. Oh, so you say, Allah says, إِن كُنْتُمْ. So you are saying, oh Rasul, tell them this message from Allah. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. You claim to love Allah, yeah? You say that your objective in life is to make Allah happy and live a good life and then die and then get Jannah. Okay, you say this. In kuntum tuhibun Allah. You say you love Allah. Allah doesn't like people that talk. Allah likes the people of action. In kuntum tuhibun Allah. You say you love Allah. Fattabi'uni. Then you need to follow me. You need to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as soon as you follow him, yuhbibukum Allah. It won't be about you loving Allah anymore. Allah will love you. And Allah loves you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. He will forgive all of your sins. So please, don't just go thinking, Ya Allah, a lesson of hadith. I swear by Allah, we are not in any sort of way capable of speaking regarding the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But these are his words, this is his way. And if by merely me reciting hadith and you listening, if our lives are not becoming more attached to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then I am failing and you are also failing. Because we live a fake life. We're not true to ourselves. Forget anyone else. We're not even true to ourselves. We sit in gatherings. We sit to ourselves and say, yeah, it's true. Yeah, I need deen. Yeah, definitely, definitely. I need deen in my life. Then what are we doing about it then, guys? What are we doing about it? These rulings of, but it's okay if I do this. Yeah, you go tell your mufti if it's okay. I don't know about muftis. I'm not mufti. I'm not an alim. But I will tell you this much. What I've learned from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What I've learned from his sunnah. Come on, ask me if it's sunnah or not. I will try to tell you that much. I won't tell you rulings of yes, haram, makruh. That's not my job. How can I defame Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Allah gives all the tawfiq to understand. This Abu Sufyan in this moment, hadith, the third hadith of Sahih Bukhari, hadith of Tawili fi qistati Hirakla. When Hirakla, the Heraclius of that time, the Roman emperor, Abu Sufyan went to him. And after going to him, qala Hirakla. Hirakla asked a few questions. A very long hadith, Imam Nawawi mentions a portion of the hadith. فَمَاذَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ? What does this man, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, what does he tell you about? يَعْنَى النَّبِيَّ صلى الله عليه وسلم, what has he informed you? Abu Sufyan, from amongst the group, he's the only one that spoke. His friends were told to face the other way. So Abu Sufyan cannot give them any sort of indirect, you know, eye contact to lie. And Abu Sufyan said that, I would have lied, but because I thought that my friends might do me over and they may speak against me, I only spoke the truth that day. He spoke the truth when he was not a Muslim. Guess what happened? Abu Sufyan says, قُلْتُ يَقُولُ, I said to Hirakla, to the emperor, that this Muhammad, this man from the Quraysh, from our tribe, he says, أُعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ, the only worship one Allah alone. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, and he commands us that we should not worship anyone else with Allah. وَتْرُكُوا مَا يَقُولُ آبَاؤُكُمْ, he has said to us to let go of those traditions of our forefathers, to let go of these silly, stupid customs of our forefathers. وَيَأْمُرُنَا بِالصَّلَاةِ, he commands us to offer salah, to offer prayer. وَالصِّدِقِ, and he tells us to be truthful. And that's why Imam Nawawi mentioned this. وَالْعَفَافِ, he tells us to remain pure in our chastity. وَالصِّلَةِ, and he tells us to have our family ties intact, to make effort with our family ties. مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ حَدِيثِ. Abu Sufyan, the ulama mentioned, Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, this is many years before accepting Islam. But one of the reasons could be, that he accepted Islam and Allah gave him the honor of Iman was because then many years ago, he still did not speak a lie against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hirakla, when he heard this, he replied, and I'm going to finish on this note, Hirakla said that what you have said, that he called you towards one Allah, and not to obey anyone else except that one Allah, all of the other prophets of the past, they also brought that message. When he said to you to let go of your customs and of your forefathers' traditions, I swear that every prophet that came before, they said the same thing. When he said, and he commanded you towards salah, every prophet has commanded his nation towards salah. وَالصِّدْقِ, only the prophets of Allah command you towards truthfulness, to be truthful. And only the prophets of Allah say to you, do not involve yourself in haram, remain pure, honor yourself, do not go into haram. And only the prophets of Allah say that sila rahmi, then make sure you keep good family ties. And Heraclius of that time, he accepted this also, that this Muhammad, what he has said is truth. Abu Sufyan, you spoke the truth also. Imam Nawawi is giving me and you the message that speak the truth. If you don't see results now, Wallahi al-Azim, later on, the way Abu Sufyan saw the result of himself and his wife Hind, the one that chewed the liver of the Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they both accepted Islam. Rasulullah entered Makkah saying, whosoever takes refuge and protection in the house of Abu Sufyan, then I, Muhammad, will not harm him. No one will harm him. Because Abu Sufyan has also accepted Islam. Abu Sufyan came to the outskirts of Makkah. He went in, all the Sahaba angry, the arch enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They wanted to destroy him. Rasulullah said, no, let him come closer. Seeing Rasulullah, that I have dishonored him for 21 years. Me and you, when someone dishonors us and destroys us or does wrong to us for 2 years, we have a heart attack. We can't take it. Rasulullah is dishonored for 21 years. That man is in front of him. 21 years of hardship. 21 years of hardship. That man is in front, and that man, after 21 years of giving you pain, his wife chewing the liver of your uncle, him coming to the Battle of Badr, the Battle of Uhud, and every other treaty, him stopping you from entering Makkah for Umrah in the time of Sulayh Hudaybiyah, him doing everything against you after 21 years, he comes to you and says, that will you be able to put aside 21 years and accept me? Because he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Upon this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave a blind eye to 21 years and he accepted it. This is something for me to think about. May the Almighty Allah make us truthful. May be the case that whatever situation, Allah allows us to speak the truth with love, with wisdom. Allah make it so that we are people of truth. Allah allow us to be in the company of the people of truth. Allah allow us so. JazakAllah khairan, please forgive me, I know I've taken a bit more Well, it's my usual time now when I started at 4:15. So I've taken 1 hour of your time. Forgive me. Literally 1, 2, 3 announcements and I will call you a day. Number one, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. As you know, Al-Adab is still growing and growing. We've come up with a different idea to kind of make you enjoy your cup of tea and your cup of coffee a bit more. We've made some mugs from Al-Adab and they have some coats on. We chose about 5 different coats. And when you look at them, inshallah, you'll be able to kind of remember the goodness that we're trying to spread and the work that we're trying to do. So when you have your nice cup of coffee or hot chocolate or tea, whatever it may be, or if you're not a tea kind of person, someone at home, try to take it, inshallah. Try to take it. You'll be doing 2 things. You'll be remembering us in your du'as. And secondly, you'll be also helping us. It's £5 a mug. All of the proceeds will go towards Al-Adab. There's 5 different coats. We've left them for display. You can choose whichever one you fancy. Second quote is, as you all know, second point is, as you all know, this is Riyadu Saliheen. This is the 12th lesson of Riyadu Saliheen through the sheer mercy of Allah. But before this, we had 148 lessons of Al-Adabul Mufrad, which started in my house, in my living room. It moved from my living room to my dining room. It moved to a different room in this Westwood High School. And now it's come to Westwood Hall in this building now. It took us 3 years to complete Al-Adabul Mufrad because of the greatness of this book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed it so that one of my dear friends, Mufti Atiq Sahib from Wernith Jamia, Manchester Road, he wanted me to start it again in his masjid on a weekly basis. And I can't do weekly because of the commitment I have for this and other things. So every first Sunday of the month, we've started Al-Adabul Mufrad. Last month in January 2017, we started our first lesson. This coming Sunday is the second lesson of Al-Adabul Mufrad. And it's the chapter of parents and being good to our parents, etc. That's what's happening right now. Many of you, bar one or two, Salim Bai, literally bar one or two, no one was here when we started the hadith lessons 3 years ago. Literally right now, if I look properly, probably Abul Qasim was there initially here and there, but from everyone, only Salim Bai was there from the first lesson, which is 3 years ago. No one else was there. And them points, I swear by Allah, I will never forget. I'm going to mention one incident to explain to you how powerful Al-Adabul Mufrad was for me and for those that came. One dear friend of mine, because the chapters was parents, and that's what none of you have heard from me right now, he spoke to me and he said to me, Ustaji, after listening to the chapter of parents, he confessed and said that I haven't spoke to my father for 7 years. He didn't speak to his father for 7 years, and his father lived abroad. And after them 7 years, I finally, through the barakah of the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that I need to make an effort with my father, with my parents, I called my father. He called his father after 7 years, after listening to the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He spoke to his father. His father recently passed away, about 2 months ago. In them 3 years, he made such a relationship. His father came back and forth, to the extent that very son, who 3 years ago did not speak to his father for 7 years, 3 years later, when his father passes away, that son is the son that makes an emergency ticket to go abroad, and that is the son that leads the janazah of his father. That is the son that leads the janazah of his father. Through the barakah of the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Not Atiq, not Al-Adab, nothing. But through the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this is what happened. So if I'm being honest with you, this is something that I don't want anyone to miss out with, especially you brothers that have not been there with me in that journey. So it's only once a month, so it's not even demanding as this Friday class. Once a month, every Sunday, it's the chapter of parents and we're moving forward with them. But only on hadith number 6 right now. So please try to join me. 7:30 is Isha Salah in Wernith Jamia. And after that, approximately 1 hour lesson. I pray that Allah gives me the tawfiq. We calculated it. If it's on a week, if it's on a monthly basis, if Allah gives me life, if Allah accepts it, then it will take approximately 12 to 13 years to complete Al-Adabul Mufrad again. It took 3 years on a weekly basis, it'll take 13 years on a monthly basis. So make dua Allah accepts, and I pray that you can take part once a month. Alhamdulillah, with an amazing audience the first month in January. So I hope to see many of the brothers, inshallah. 7:30, inshallah. Last announcement. Here, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, the way we have an attachment with hadith, every Monday now we have the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being discussed. Monday tafsir. So this now the 6th lesson this Monday coming. Please do try to take part. The Book of Allah has it's a completely different atmosphere, different message altogether. It is the words of Allah. It's not the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, rather the words of Allah, our Creator. So do try to take part in Monday too. If you can't make it, it's difficult coming so many times a week. at least listen online or try to benefit in some sort of way. I pray that Allah keeps us all sincere. Jazakallah khairan. Please make dua for me. I will always make dua for all of you. Allah make us people that only speak the truth. Allah resurrect us with the truth, truthful people. May we have the title of Siddiq, and may we be amongst those people who will always defend Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who will defend our mother, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, who is also the truthful. May Allah ta'ala bless everyone. Jazakallahu khairan. Subhanallah.